Hello, hello, everybody. It is 11:08 a.m. Central Time on the 17th of February, 2019. We are here on Sunday afternoon, or right at noon, right about noon, to do an update for you, seismically speaking, of course. And for those of you who are new here, let me quickly turn on a display capture. You can see me on the screen for just a second here. I'm wearing my triggered NPC shirt, sweater, from Mark Dice. God bless him. God bless him. Love that stuff. Turn on a display capture now so you can see what I see. And we're going to be talking about a big earthquake that struck over here in the West Pacific. And we're also going to be talking about our deep earthquakes. The deep earthquakes you can see raised high off the globe as compared to the earthquakes right on the surface of the planet. This indicates shallow earthquakes right on the surface, and the higher off the planet we go, the deeper these are into the Earth. Why does it matter? Well, deep earthquakes usually lead to shallower, larger earthquake activity within several days of the deep earthquakes occurring. And the more deep earthquakes we have, the more bigger, shallower earthquakes we tend to see. Now, the location of this 6.4 to 6.5, coming in the Solomon Islands. This is east of Papua New Guinea. This is Papua New Guinea right here. The color coding on these earthquakes, the pinkish colored earthquakes, are from yesterday, and the whitish colored earthquakes are from today. So let's get yesterday's events out of there. So you can see pretty much the last 24 hours here, and clearly our big earthquake is sandwiched in between two deep earthquakes, and it looks like the middle point because it is the middle point between our two deep sets of quakes. We call the middle point the fulcrum point, the point where most of the energy rests between our areas that are in current motion. Now, an earthquake has just popped off here over in the Indian Ocean, South Indian Ocean. We'll talk about that in a moment. But 6.4 to 6.5 coming in at the middle fulcrum point, the depth of the earthquake at 367 to 371 kilometers, depending on which agency you go with. So USGS has it at 6.4 at 367 kilometers deep, and I think the EMSC has it at 371 kilometers deep, 6.5. Okay, so the difference is minuscule. Now we need to go consult our depth to magnitude conversion chart. And this is put together by Bella and Rebecca, two of our fellow researchers. And we need to go over and look at 370 on the chart, which is about right in the middle. Look where my mouse is. And we'll just go down to the green column here, 370. And we need to add on 0.7 to 0.75 magnitude to this. So we look at the green column, and then you look at the white column next to it. The green column is depth, the white column is magnitude that we add on. So quite literally, we add on 0.7 magnitude to this. This takes us up to the potential of a 7.1 earthquake. Again, if you add on 0.7 to this, that takes us up to 7.1 magnitude. So we have a potential of a 7.1 magnitude to pop up next to this within the next 7 days or so, within the next week. We watch for about a week. 7 to 10 days is what I watch on these deep quakes like this, especially this size. So if we have a deep 6.4, we watch for up to 7 to 10 days in the areas next to the deep earthquake. And when I say next to, I mean adjacent to. And we don't just look anywhere adjacent to, we look between our sets of earthquakes, in our fulcrum points. So this big earthquake is the fulcrum point between these two deep quakes. And then we look at the fulcrum point between these three quakes here. And we look at the fulcrum point between these two quakes here. And we go to the north and we watch the fulcrum point between these two quakes here. And we go further to the north and we watch the fulcrum point in Japan between these two sets of quakes. We keep going. We go and watch the fulcrum point between these two sets of quakes. And we continue over to the United States and we watch the fulcrum point between these two sets of quakes, all the way around the plate. That's how you do earthquake forecasting. You look to the fulcrum points between our sets of quakes, and you take into account our deep earthquakes. The deep earthquakes can lead to shallower, larger events, and that's why we, again, pay attention to those events. Now, I haven't checked the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center, so we should probably go over and check that, see if anything's going on the volcano end. Okay. Looks like Etna in Italy, Sabancaya in Peru, Popocatépetl in Mexico, Planchon Petoroa in Chile. Nothing changing there, but we do have a change in the Northwest Pacific. Chvaletsk was going. Now we can add in Kerensky up to 12,000 feet. So Kerensky and Chvaletsk going side by side. We also have Dikono, which is daily in Indonesia. Reventador in Ecuador, daily in Ecuador. Nevados de Chilean, puff emissions. Ah, hold on. Everybody put on the brakes. Katovar over in Papua New Guinea, also back to life. And Sakurajima, we've got Sakurajima going on the feed, and there's been a lot going on there. So I don't think anybody's shocked by that. It's almost a daily occurrence. But Katovar, Nevados de Chilean. Who else? Poes, okay. That goes into yesterday. All right, well, Katovar was last night, actually. Look at that. So we have Poes, and then last night, Katovar. Looks like 6,000-foot-high blast at Katovar. Anybody else? Jeez. Fuego yesterday, Kerensky again. Poes, Nevados de Chilean. Anybody else? Okay. Cordon call, don't be alarmed by that. That was the end of the 15th. All right. Well, why does it matter? Why am I looking up all these volcanoes? Because the volcanoes play into our seismic activity. So this big, deep quake right here, why am I making such a big deal about Katovar volcano? It's right here, right in the middle of this red arrow. And look what's right next to it, a new 4.6 earthquake last night. So 4.6 earthquake next to Katovar. Katovar is erupting, then new big, deep earthquake right next to it. We go over to the west, and we have Dukono volcano erupting. Right here, make note, everything to the west has stopped. Krakatau stopped, Kerensky stopped, Sinabung stopped, Agung stopped. Just make note of that, that's abnormal. To have all those erupt and then all stop with new deep earthquakes hammering up from down below, that's going to change, most likely. I don't forecast eruptions, but when you go all silent after big eruptions, usually leads to more eruptions, especially if there's new deep earthquakes, creating pressure on those magma chambers. Imagine it like this. The magma chambers are nestled into the plate, like an egg. And on all sides, of course, are stowed portions of the plate. Then the plate comes under pressure, squeezing in on that magma chamber on all sides. Now that's going to push, of course, onto the magma chamber, and it's going to try to release out and up. And that's what happened. That's why we see volcanic increases at times of new deep earthquakes. Pressure is created inside the plate, which then puts pressure on these chambers inside the plate, which then squeezes on the contents inside the plate, and then it comes up and out. Okay, and that leads us across Asia, where, once again, yesterday they did report an earthquake out of Mongolia, a 4.2, proof that they can report earthquakes out of here. Look where it is. It's right at the tip of our arrow. But in the last day, no earthquakes again. So I don't know what to make of it, guys. There's no earthquakes being reported out of China and Russia. It's not that there's radio silence out here from Mother Nature, it's that humans aren't reporting the earthquakes. And they even cut our back end way to view to see if there were any. So that lets me know something's going on. I mean, they cut the back end feed from NNC. I mean, what more do you need? Oh, is that just chance or coincidence? Okay. Never convince me of that. I don't know who else we'd be trying to convince. So if you can't convince me, for crying out loud, I'm quote-unquote Dutch Sense Online. If you can't convince me, you got a problem. Let's go over to the west. Go across Iran and go into Turkey. And again, out of Iran, nothing. So nothing in Iran, nothing in China, nothing over in Russia. That's not accurate. There are earthquakes across here. We're just not getting the report. So I would assume, and sometimes assuming makes an ass between you and me, but between you and me, I'm going to say they're being the asses. There are fours and fives striking out here in the past several days. And that's going to affect everybody downstream according to what we expect with the flow coming out of Asia. And that pools up here north of India, and then it pools up in western Iran at the Iraq border, then it presses over to the west following the plate boundaries. Now look what happened. The central Aegean Sea got hit twice or thrice in the past 2 days. So the western portion over in Greece started to swarm out over next to the Ionia Range. Then in the central Aegean on both sides of it, two fours. Now this is a step below what I was expecting. I was expecting something to go up to mid-range five. But when you get a cluster of fours across a whole area, I'll consider that an earthquake forecast hit. If the whole region moves on a 4.0 basis, and then we take it down a step and we add in swarms at each spot. Now, there could very well be one more day to go in this, guys. I mean, I issued my warning on Wednesday, so it would stand till this coming Wednesday for the next 7 days. But here we are, right, where all three sets overlap. Where do they all overlap? In the warned area. So the warned area right here in the middle could still be under stress, but I will consider this already the Aegean Sea moving. Now going across, now again, it's borderline again. I was looking for a 5.5 to get this. It's low, way low. So I don't know. We'll wait. I'll give it a day and we'll wait. So up to the west by northwest, we go across the plate boundaries. Where did we end up? Well, guys, take a look. 2.7 right next to the border of Austria and Slovakia. This puts us into where? Hungary? Yep. Croatia, Hungary, Slovakia. You remember I had my little trip up here. I called it Slovenia, and I had to apologize. I didn't want to offend anyone. Well, now there it is. A new 2.7. Same sized earthquake, 2.9, struck up at the Italy-Swiss border in the Swiss Alps. Now, this goes right along the edge of the craton and right up past our arrow where we were pointing. Here's our arrow where it was pointing, and it went right up here. Now, don't forget, a day and a half ago, the earthquakes that struck over in Romania. Romania got hit, as well as the South UK. Now, it's not a coincidence that a 2.7 struck here, then a 2.9 struck here, then another 2.9 struck here, and then going down to the south, our bigger movement, 4.3 in North Morocco at the Gibraltar Strait, and look what happened out here. First, we got our 6.2 2 days ago, then followed up right at the Azores, both sides of the Azores moving, 5.3 and 4.7 on both sides of our letter X. X marks the spot for where the energy ends up. And the energy coming out of where? Our 6.1 to 6.2 that struck here, east of India, that you don't even see on the feed because the USGS downgraded it to a 4.9. Why does a 4.9 matter? Well, look at this one. This 4.8 to 4.9 here in Myanmar and the new earthquake that just struck down here, southeast of Madagascar, 4.8 and 4.9. Sure are a lot of 4.9 striking all over the place, wouldn't you say? If you watched any of my videos over the past few days, you'll know that the whole plate moved on a 4.9 basis. 4.9s all over the planet. All the same sized earthquake everywhere. The entire planet moved on a 4.9 basis. It's alarming. You should contact all your friends and family, loved ones, coworkers. Let them know the whole planet moved on a 4.9 basis per the USGS. And 4.9 specifically, everywhere. From Fiji to Japan to Europe, all the way across Russia, off the west coast of the United States, going down here off the coast of South America, then going over to Africa even. 4.9s all over the planet in the course of a day's time. It was amazing. That just happened a few days ago. So now here we are, and we're dealing with large earthquakes all over the planet. Well, large, when I say large, I mean fives, going all the way around the entire planet, reaching out from where our deep earthquakes happened. That all happened over the past several days. Take a look at it. Here, maybe I should turn off all our smaller events. Look at the fives and greater. Starting down here at Fiji, going up and all the way over. Then the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, one side of the planet to the other. Now connecting in between there, you're going to say, well, Dutch, there are no earthquakes across this region. Wrong. Taking it down to 4.9, well, you don't see it anymore. Again, this gets back to this past week. You take it down to 4.9 and it goes all the way across. So, what about the earthquakes coming out of China and Russia? They matter because it shows a connecting point between here, where our 6.2 is, where this 6.2 is that they took down to 4.9, and all the way back over across to where this new 6.4 is. It's all connected. The energy transfers across the planet. It's no shock that this happens. We watch for this to happen on a regular basis. So where the energy starts? The deep earthquakes down below. That's where the energy starts. Where it ends up? Antipode, the opposite side of the planet, on our X's. So it starts where the D's are, and it ends where the X's are. But when I say ends, it really is recycled back through the planet. And when it hits and X marks the spot, if it's in the upper 4 to 5.0 or greater range, it goes back through the planet and comes back out on the antipode. So for instance, where this 5.0 is, down here at the South Sandwich Islands, going in at our letter X, coming out in the next couple days, on the opposite side of the planet, up here, next to where our letter D is, going down towards North Japan, here we should get a new deep earthquake. and the deep earthquake should be something in the 5.0 range or a little less, maybe 4.5, 4.7, 4.9, somewhere up to 5. Going in on one side of the planet, coming out on the other, within days, starting the cycle over again. I know. Well, it calls the whole core of the Earth into question, doesn't it, if you start to think about it? Looking at South America, a spread of fours, and in the middle of it all, a new five striking in North Argentina, just south of the Bolivia border. And this comes in next to our other letter D, which was also hit by moderately deep earthquakes over the past several days. So we had a little bit of a hammering action coming in on the underside of the plate, and a spread. Look at the last several days here in South America, and look at our fives, or 4.9s and greater. But you'll see it, an equal distribution across South America going all the way down to the South Sandwich Islands. Same-sized earthquakes that strike here, strike down here. And we watch for it to happen on a regular basis. Now back here, where the arrows are, you see where it says travels underneath? We have two different volcanoes, Planchon Petoroa and Nevados de Chilean, both erupting. Same with up to the north, right next to this big set of earthquakes right here, where our letter V is, that's Sabancaya volcano. It's also moving big time, seismically speaking. Going up into Ecuador here, this is a Reventador volcano, again surrounded by earthquakes. It's not just chance or coincidence. If they could strike anywhere, they would. But they're striking along the plate boundaries, next to where our eruptions are happening, and the eruptions and the earthquakes are all caused, one more time, let me repeat myself again, are all caused by these deep earthquakes hammering up on the underside of the plate a world away, as the force flows across the entire plate and then hits South America like a wall. It's not a coincidence that two of the same-sized earthquakes, 4.7 and 4.8, struck over the past 3 to 4 days, coming across the Pacific. I've likened this many times before to a train going across a trestle or a bridge. As it goes across the bridge, it's vibrating. But at the end of the bridge, it's going to hit something large. It's going to hit a mountain. And it's going to be derailed and go around that. And that's exactly what happened. Look at our trajectory of earthquakes going from here to here to here, and from here over to here, and then going around South America. Maybe I need to turn down the rings. So like water hitting a rock in a river, a large boulder in a river, and breaking on it and going around. That's what's happening. It's going around to the north and going around to the south, and we get two of the same sized earthquakes, 4.8 up here, and 4.9 to 5.0 down here, preferring to the south ever so slightly, less resistance to the south than to the north. Same thing happened across Central America, an equal spread of the same sized earthquakes. Take a look. Equal distantly spaced. I could even turn the rings off. You should still be able to see the equal distance spacing of the same size quakes within a hair of a point of one another. 4.4, 4.6, 4.4, 4.5, 4.7, 4.5, 4.9, biggest in the middle. And then we spread out again, and we go 4.5, 4.8, 4.7, and then we go down to the biggest in the middle again. So we have fulcrum points between our sets of areas that are moving. Isn't it amazing? Let's look at what else hit. The Eastern Caribbean lit up with new activity going up to near, let's say, mid-range 3. So a bunch of mid-range 3s and multiple 2s, but this is low. We're going to expect this in the next day or less. Again, I issued my forecast on Wednesday night to get us through this week. And then tonight, of course, is Sunday night, so it's kind of overlapping a little bit. I'm still expecting this, for this to happen. Also up in Alaska, we'll get into Alaska in a second. I'm still looking for it, guys. I warned on Wednesday night, and here we are on Sunday, and all this else is going on now. So it looks like things are on schedule, or at least following up very shortly. Central America, South Mexico. Well, Popocatépetl is erupting here. Fuego is erupting here. And we go down to the south, and we had major activity at two volcanoes. That was Turrialba and Poás. So that's four volcanoes in the past few days right across Central America. But this has dropped off to all threes. Notice, it's all threes in the last day. You have to go back a couple days to get fours. So earthquake intensity, the power behind this is going down. I don't like it. If it goes down like this, that means it's probably going to wing back up or swing back up in the next few days. Go from threes back up to upper fives maybe. Maybe even a six. With what's going on now, on this side of the plate, there is going to be compensation on the other side, the opposite side, western side, eastern side, moving back and forth over the course of days. It happens, and look for it to happen. That includes in Mexico. And again, our fulcrum points, our middle points between our sets of earthquakes are the spots where we watch. Now, we have huge open areas that we call silent zones. These are the easiest fulcrum points to identify. So between this set of quakes and this set of quakes, we have a middle point. Obviously, that brings us into Panama, South Costa Rica, North Colombia. But here, there's several fulcrum points between each set of earthquakes. So for instance, here, between these two sets, one fulcrum point. Here's another fulcrum point. Here's another fulcrum point. Here's another fulcrum point. Here's another fulcrum point. You get the picture. Each fulcrum point, at least starting between each, should be filled in by a larger earthquake than what's currently here now. So if we have a set of threes, I would look to the middle for a four. And if we have a whole boatload of threes, I would look to the middle of all of them for something larger. Okay, do you see how this works? It's fairly simple in the overall principle, but you have to start to take into account all the magnitudes and the volcanoes and the nearby plate boundaries. We don't even really look at fault zones too much. We only really look at the plate boundaries. Those are the main directors. Those are the main avenues. And then you may have side streets that are fault zones, but we look to the main avenues, the highways, the interstates, and so forth of this seismic flow. This leads me up into Alaska. Well, a few days ago, on Wednesday, when I issued my warning, it was quiet up here. There were no earthquakes. Then I issued my warning. And this is what's hit since we issued the warning. Now, the warning's for the Central Aleutian Island chain to be on watch for something in the upper sixth level. That goes till Wednesday night. So we're here Sunday night. Normally, I would be doing my forecast tonight, but we're slightly off. I'm going to correct that this week, though. We'll double up on the forecast this coming Sunday. Not tonight, but this coming Sunday. So we'll see this Wednesday forecast through, then we'll be off for 2 days, and then we'll just issue a new forecast on Sunday. And this has all lit up since. And right in the middle, in between our sets of fives, is our spot where I'm still watching for something in the upper six level to hit. Now also, going across the mainland of Alaska, a new set of quakes going up to near four struck next to Mount McKinley, just northwest of Anchorage. Now, Anchorage started to swarm. No exaggeration there. Multiple new earthquakes striking in Anchorage proper and then going up to Mount McKinley. Northern slopes also started to move. This is all the same size movement. 3.7, 3.5, 3.4, 3.3, and then our bigger activity out in the Aleutians. No shock there. It's the plate boundary. But the plate boundary is going to get hit. You see where it starts north of Japan, and you see where it goes over to the northern slopes of Alaska, next to the drill points and the pumping operations. So watch in the middle. That's where we watch for a few more days to go till Wednesday night. Over here in Japan, big open silent zone here on the coast of Japan, east by northeast of Tokyo, or south by southeast of the coast of Honshu. Guys, it's the most famous earthquake zone on the planet, and you've got new deep earthquakes down to the south. You've got a line of fours and fives just stopping just shy of Japan proper. This is just south of Okinawa, or northeast of Taiwan, 5.2. Then, right here, Sakurajima sending off new blast and a big open area on the coast. The open area is building. There should be earthquake activity there. It's been 48 hours. 48 hours, no earthquakes in the most famous earthquake zone on the planet? Well, I mean, I shouldn't say no earthquakes. There's small microquakes, ones, twos, threes, but no noteworthy activity for multiple days. How many days do we have to go back to get anything there? We have to go back 4 to 5 days to get a 4.2 on the coast of Japan. Look where these rings overlap. That is the spot that I watch. So watch for what? Watch for something larger than anything that you see right here around it now. This takes us up a notch, up to the mid-range 5 level or larger, maybe even to 6-ish. With this going on, a new deep 6.4, don't kid yourselves, there's enough force coming up from down below the plate to carry on a event for multiple days across the West Pacific, to spread out like a crack in a windshield from this point up and around through Japan over towards the United States and out and over towards all the way across towards the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. This right here has enough force to go all the way over to here and go all the way up and around to the United States and to go back against the flow and hit over here in South America. That's how big this is. This is a disturbance happening down below the whole plate, not just a little portion in the plate. It displaces whole portions of the plate. Thousands of miles across get displaced from underneath as something like this happens. And then the whole plate corresponds, and the plates attached to the corresponding plate then respond themselves. Okay, this leads me into the United States mainland and out here to Hawaii. So out in Hawaii, what's going on? A dramatic flare-up in activity. Look at this. I think even the untrained eye should see this and be like, what? The north tip of the big island just got a 3.1? Why? Why did an earthquake strike here? Longtime viewers, you should already know what's up here at the north tip of the island, but I'll show you again, just in case you don't remember the name. Kohala. See this? It says Kohala. This is an Ice Age Pleistocene volcanic formation on the north tip of the island where one of these big landslides happened in the past, the ones that caused big tsunamis. You can see where the landslide happened. This has actually been documented. You can read a lot of interesting material on this. Let me bring this in and show you the slopage on it. There we go. All right, now you get the picture. So this thing, apparently at some point in the past, the sides of here collapsed and formed massive tsunamis around the area that not just inundated the island, but even went Pacific-wide. Now, Kohala is a large ancient volcanic field that you should be able to see some of these. Well, here, let me bring this back down, looking more directly down on it. There we go. We have a cone here, a spatter cone. We have craters that are covered in trees. That's how old this is, just to give you a picture of. Again, we're dealing with just ancient volcanism here on Hawaii. Now, this goes all the way down to the coast, but you have to look pretty close to find the ancient buttes and the ancient spatter cones. But it carries on. There's one right here. There's another one here. And they go down out to sea, where they're out to sea. And it carries on out, actually, in between Maui and the Big Island. So a 3.1. I mean, it's nothing to scoff at the ancient volcano there. But what if I told you that 3.1 is almost the exact same magnitude that struck down here at Mauna Loa and up here next to Mauna Kea, as well as over here next to Hualalai? Let me show you all of these formations. Here is Hualalai. We got a new near 3.1 there in the past couple weeks or less. We got a new 3.1 up here next to Mauna Kea up to the east by northeast. We got a new 3.1 and swarm that broke out at Mauna Loa. And down here next to Lo'ihi, a new 3.1 and new series of earthquake swarmage. Then a more rare earthquake struck out here over to the east side of the island that I looked up on. The only thing I could find were some undersea mounts that were not even named. Or I couldn't find a name on. They probably are named, but couldn't find a name in Google Earth. That's a better way to put it. So in other words, the whole island centered around this, Kilauea, which has not been hit by a recent 3.1 or similar sized earthquake, or any swarmage major. It's been all around this volcano, all around Kilauea. Why is that? Kilauea collapsed. This past year, Kilauea collapsed and all its contents, or half of its contents, spilled out via fissures that opened up here next to Lalani Estates. Massive lava flow. I think they've got shots of it here now. So massive lava flow at Lalani Estates and the Middle East Rift Zone. This whole thing drained out, and this is the top. So this, let me bring it at an angle again. Right, yeah, angle helps, really does. So Kilauea here, down at the base of Mauna Loa, this collapsed down by several thousand feet into its magma chamber. When the top collapsed, it pushed down, of course, and when it pushed down on the magma chamber, it pushed down and out and over to the lowest point. Lowest point over here, Lalani Estates, on the eastern southeast slope, coming down at an angle, it broke out down here. Then the magma, down, down, down it went, and it equalized. When it reached down here, next to Lalani, where the fractures split, this whole magma chamber had drained down at least this far. So imagine like a lake, or a chamber filled with water, and then it drains down to at least here, parallel to Lalani Estates. So then Lalani Estates stopped draining, and it healed over, or hardened over. And then this started to refill and repressurize. When this started to refill and repressurize, all the way up here at the top at Kilauea, this is a huge gravel pit now, or a rubble pit. It doesn't look anything like this anymore. This crater is gone, and 3/4 of the caldera is gone. It's all just a rubble pit several thousand feet deep. Well, new gases started to shoot up out of this thing. Steam emissions, sulfur dioxide, and the USGS cut the live feed and said there was nothing going on and issued statements saying the volcano stopped erupting. Now, we know it's only half done erupting. It drained out, healed over, and is refilling when it reaches a point where it gets overpressurized, because this will not allow for the escaping of the magma itself or the pressure that's created in the magma chamber down below. It will eventually blow. When it blows, it'll blow a new crater, or even a new caldera. Could do both, or it could just do a crater from inside the rubble pit. Either way, it'll be a huge blast. It won't be as big as Mount St. Helens, but it will be way bigger than the 30,000-foot-high blast that happened when this thing got blocked for a couple days. You got to understand, this crater here is gone. 3/4 of this is gone, but inside of the crater was a lava lake. The lava lake was fed by tubes that went down into the magma chamber. So this lava lake is not there, and the tubes that fed it are collapsed upon. But eventually, there will be a new blast to release that pressure once it builds. And what's happening now? The pressure is building here, and it's spreading out to the other volcanoes, connected like a plumbing system. The whole big island at some point is all tied together. They used to say it wasn't, that these were all unrelated volcanoes and there's no connection between them. Well, wait, no, that's not the case now. There's a seismic connection. Whether or not you want to say the magma chambers are connected, there is a seismic connection between all the volcanoes on Hawaii, and now we've seen the same magnitude, 3.1, strike at all the different volcanoes in the last couple of weeks. While we go over to the USGS HVO site, and we see hogwash nonsense like this. Okay? And I don't even know what to say. I don't even know what to say in response to hogwash like this. Their last update, November 30th, 2018? Their last pictures, November of 2018, on something that happens once every few hundred years. Now, guess what? The last day they did any real updates was the start of tourist season. The last day of fall. The first day of winter. Or no, the last day of summer. The first day of fall. When the tourist season started, that's when they stopped. Do you think that's a coincidence? So why am I spending all this time on Hawaii? New 3.1's going all the way across the island. I got a lot of viewers out there, and you're probably curious as to why that's happening. It's all tied to the Middle East Rift Zone refilling, which means all those tourists and all the people that are there with their houses and everything need to be aware that eventually, and I still stand by it, I think months instead of years, that eventually this will blow out a new crater. Let's hope it's just a new crater as opposed to a new caldera. Will it shift again? Or again, it's going to take a big push. It'll take a big series of deep earthquakes, or a series of big deep earthquakes, I should say, that causes that once it creates enough pressure below the whole Pacific plate. When we start seeing multiple volcanoes go off gangbusters across the Pacific again, you guys remember when this happened with Hawaii to begin with, we were going through just a massive deep earthquake event. There was something like 100 different deep earthquakes in the course of a few weeks' time. That many. So that was hammering off on the underside of the plate when Hawaii first started and collapsed. So I think it'll take something similar in size to get it to blow again. That leads me back into the continental United States, where we're dealing with the same sized earthquakes that we're talking about out here in Hawaii. Take a look at this. Inside the park at Yellowstone, a 3.1 earthquake. And let me zoom in on it. If you guys aren't familiar, this is the northwest tip of Wyoming. 3.1 earthquake, it's pretty significant. It's 14 kilometers west of Old Faithful Geyser. That's how close we are. We are inside the park. We don't normally see earthquakes like this. Normally, it's tremors. Tremors are small vibrations as the magma shifts down below the plate. But in this case, we're talking earthquakes, actual fracturing in the plate. You know, you see some sinkholes that are here. Don't worry, these are not volcanic formations. These are sinkholes that form in the area, but it's probably from seismic movement. No doubt about that. The seismic movement can lead to sinkholes, caves that form and collapse very quickly as shifting happens. But there you go, Yellowstone at the park. If you ever get a chance to go, you got to go there. I mean, I'm serious. You got to go up here. If you're from the States or if you're from out of the country, you ever come to the United States, go to Yellowstone. Go there. Do it. It's worth it. And it's just awesome. Okay, let's get down here into Texas. I issued a warning for Texas, and Texas has now been hit. Where did we issue the warning for? We issued the warning for the western panhandle out here in the tip of Texas, right where the star is. Well, that's where the earthquake is. That's where we issued the warning. It's a 3.0, and there was a swarm that hit in Southern California, which caused this. So a swarm in Southern California over on the San Andreas Imperial Fault transferred pressure over to the east onto the edge of the Craton, which goes right down through West Texas. I guess I should show that to you first. Here's the Craton diagram. And just take a look at West Texas. Do you see that? So West Texas goes right down through West Texas. Now that you've seen that, here's the earthquake epicenter. And you'll see there's some volcanoes up here, but we're far enough away from those that I'm more interested in what's right next to the earthquake epicenter. And you'll begin to see there's these little cleared out pads that are all over the place here. And I'll just kind of click around and hopefully you'll see them. Now we zoom in on the pads and you'll start to see there's tanks and pipelines and jacks and pumps and well heads. This is a large oil and gas pumping operation. And it goes on and on for miles where it really gets into the, you know, very intense number of drilling points. Look at this. They've got a team of people out there with the derrick and everything. Pipeline doing new drilling as of 2014. And the shadows of the oil wells are unmistakable. The shadows of the pumps, I mean. And the size of this operation, I mean, it is something that's huge. Now, Texas is known for its drill points and oil production. But as force flows across the plate, it hits these drill points. Hits them directly, and one more time, edge of the craton becomes displaced. 2.9, 2.6. And over to the east, over on the New Madrid seismic zone, south Missouri, southwest of New Madrid, Missouri, and north by northeast of Little Rock, Arkansas. Let's go put the coordinates in and show you what's nearby here. Over in Arkansas, on the New Madrid seismic zone, no less. Let's go take a look. This is right in my neighborhood. You guys know I'm from outside of St. Louis now. I grew up in St. Louis, but live about an hour west now. Okay, beautiful location, right? It is. It really is a beautiful location. Let's zoom in and see if we have anything nearby. Do we have anything standing out? Well, looking around, you're going to see some quarrying, of course. And you see houses and all kinds of wonderful stuff. I'm going to turn on my wells and my place marks. See this pipeline? Pipeline goes down to a series of huge drill points. Now, this imagery date, let's see. When is our imagery date on this? 2014. It's a real shame because I gave up on doing my place marks long about that time. Here's our oil and gas pumping operations that I stopped marking, but carry on. They really do. I mean, look how many there are. They just carry on everywhere. And I gave up on place marking them because look how many I did. And when I refresh the imagery, there's this many more. So every one of these little pads, they're not houses. You have to zoom in and see it. You'll see they're not houses. They are all oil and gas drill points. So when you start getting this many oil and gas drill points everywhere, you create a weak point in the edge of the plate. And it keeps going and keeps going across the counties. I'm not exaggerating when I say these are all different drill points. On the New Madrid seismic zone. Right behind the houses. I mean, here's a house. Here's an oil pumping operator. It's like twice as big as the houses. Okay, so we keep going and going and we go up to the north and you can see the little pads just keep on going. And this imagery date is again as of 2014. So have they gone into this county? There may very well be some here in this county. Our imagery is not going to show it. They've put a moratorium on to the drill points. I know they did that for a little while. So we'll have to wait to see if they're doing some directly next to here. But certainly, I'm going to have to say, we are close enough with the thousands of drill points right next to this that it's most likely related to our drill points. So far, what have we covered? We've covered Yellowstone 3.1. We've covered down in West Texas. And there's no activity, at least any significant activity, to report to you out of Oklahoma. Let's go over here into Utah. Take a look at this 3.3. Where is it? Fillmore, Utah. 8 kilometer depth. Fillmore. What's at Fillmore? Is there anything nearby Fillmore? Well, right next to it, we have Black Rock Desert Volcano. Wow, is this Smithsonian marked? Yeah, it sure is. Black Rock Desert Volcanic Field consists of a group of closely spaced small volcanic fields of Pleistocene to Holocene Age in the Black Rock and Sevier deserts of South Central Utah. And it's big. But there's also something else next to this. Right across over into here, we have a series of oil and gas pumping operations that go on for miles. Now, at this height, you probably can't see that. You see my place mark up here. But if I didn't have the place marks on, would you even see them? Let me zoom in and show you what to look for. You have to zoom in and look for these. You look for these little square pads again that are cut out of the landscape. And then you zoom in closer and closer and closer and closer. You have to get down to ground level, basically. And you can see the shadow of the jack or pump. And then you see it goes on through these towns out around the hillsides. And it stops just south of town here. And it goes all the way up north, and you just follow these little pads, which again are like somewhat surreptitiously, you know, they're hard to see. They're snuck out here into the little spots all over in the crags of the desert. And then it gets really densely populated the further north we go with more and more drill points. But this is next to a volcano. So two of these, the 3.1 and 3.3, next to volcanoes. These three, next to drill points. Pretty interesting. What about over in California? At this point, let's turn down the rings a little bit. You'll see a 3.1 up in Northeast California, and then just north of the Bay Area, a 3.7 to 3.8. I wonder if anybody felt this. Let's go see if we have any shake felt reports from the USGS north of the Bay Area. 3,341 people felt this? I wonder if it was a bigger earthquake. Hold on. Anytime I see something like that, I want to go check the local magnitude list. Okay, we throw out the low end, and we throw out the high end, and that gives us a better idea of what the earthquake really is. So, high end, so far I'm seeing a 4.3 highest detected. We'll throw that out if that's the highest. And anything else? Fours. We got several fours on the list. A lot of fours. Sure do have a lot of fours on the list. The highest we're going is 4.4. Well, we throw out the 4.3s. We'll throw out the 4.3s and we'll throw out the 4.2s. That still leaves us with an upper 3 to near 4. Now, they have it at 3.7 to 3.8. What's the difference? What's the difference of 0.2 between friends? Let's go pull the coordinates over at Yountville, California. This is bringing us in right next to somewhere else that my longtime viewers should be very familiar with. Are you ready? Are you ready? Where are we going? Now, I'm surprised they don't have this triangulated from the spot that we always check, but it is slightly different. It's Napa Valley, but this right here. We go here on a daily basis, anywhere from Geyser Peak all the way down here to Castle Rock Springs. And when I zoom in on the area, I show you these on a nightly basis when the swarms hit here at Geysers, California. So Geysers, California, and the volcano here, Clear Lake, has been drilled, where humans have come in and drilled into the upper reaches above the magma chamber to get steam. These pipelines go to the turbines. The turbines turn via the steam and provide electricity to the area. And they've done it all over here. Look how many turbines there are. And look how many pipelines there are. And look how many drill points there are going around the volcano. So we're just south of the volcano on the San Andreas with a 3.8 to near 4.0. I'll call it a 4 because that's really probably what it is. Now let's go up here to the east by northeast. A 3.1 coming in 3 kilometers south of Belden, California. and it's a negative 1.2 kilometer depth earthquake. It's basically a surface earthquake. Let's go see if there's something there. Is there anything of significance nearby this spot that could lead to something like a surface earthquake? Well, I'm just seeing nothing but mountain peaks at this location. What is at Belden? Anybody know what's at Belden? How about Paradise, California? Does that ring any bells? It's the same spot where the fires broke out, guys. Like, exactly in the same spot on the east side of Paradise. Back here, back on the back side that went all the way around. It's right on the back side. But we're also just east by southeast of our volcanic fields that go up to Lassen Volcanic Center. I'm going to get a measurement because I always look within 40 miles for the nearest volcano. The magma chambers can shift that far in that distance. That distance can be moved in a long period of time. The plate can shift, or the magma chamber down below can be moved at an angle. Plates move, whole sections of the plates move. So 40 miles can happen over the course of quote unquote millions of years of their time. Look, 37 miles to the center of Mount Lassen, or 28 miles to Maidu. Maidu is the spot that got hit before the fires broke out. Okay, now let's go down to the east by southeast. These are just our significant sized earthquakes for the day. This is not incorporating in the small earthquakes yet. Let's go get this 3.4 down in Southern California. This all happened today. Look, 100 felt reports out at Tehachapi. Longtime viewers, you know what's next to Tehachapi. Bakersfield, Southern South San Joaquin Valley. Here's the earthquake epicenter in the foothills. And it looks like we do have some old dirt roads there. But you back it out, and what are we right next to? See this? It's marked oil field. I just have it marked as oil field because the wells go on. 4 miles in all directions. All of these. Oil and gas. Oil and gas. And it keeps going on down to the south. So I'll measure the distance to see how far we are from the earthquake epicenter. Over 17 miles to the center of the oil field, and well, we're right at 10 miles. Here is 10 miles. I look 6 to 10 miles. So, I mean, we're on the edge of one of the largest pumping operations in Southern California, or even, you could even say, on the West Coast when you incorporate this in. That the deposits that are being removed in here, the amount of oil that is being taken out, definitely that many drill points across this whole southern portion. This is marked as oil field too, because it is right in the middle of the orchards. They're not pumping water. And it goes out into the desert. It just keeps going everywhere where one of these little square pads is. And it just keeps going and going and going all the way to the south, and then it curls back around over to the east. So it's no exaggeration for me to say it's drilled from here up to here, around, down through here, back around, even down to here. And overdrive, as if this wasn't enough right here, this whole thing right here, this whole section, it looks like a mountain range, right? Well, it was. I say was because I'm speaking in past tense terms. It was a mountain range. But we'll zoom in, and now it looks like sand dunes, right? We'll zoom in some more. Those aren't sand dunes. Those aren't, well, they're roads going in between the little pads, but every single mountaintop here, or every single hillside, has been scraped off. And they have nothing but oil and gas wells on every single scrape point, connected by pipelines, of course. Now look at it. Not just this, it goes down to here, and it goes further down there, and it goes over to the west by northwest, where it even gets even more densely drilled. Do you see? Here, let me bring it in at street level. Here we go. Here's where the roads connect. We have a Y intersection here. Okay. Hopefully you guys can see all this, can't you? Okay, you can. Now, I'm not against oil and gas, and I say this 1,000 times. We're the number one energy producer on the planet, But somebody somewhere has to understand that if you create this many drill points, this many weak points next to an active seismic zone, this is the San Andreas, this diagonal line. It's taken the shape of the mountain. Mountain ranges have taken the shape of the fault zone over time, of the bending. So if you come over and create perforations, thousands of them going out miles and down thousands of feet across a whole region, you shouldn't be shocked when seismic pressure comes down your way and it prefers to you as opposed to following the fault. It's just basic 101 here. It's like breaks in concrete, only much bigger. So you put a break in concrete to allow for when the expansion or shrinking of the concrete, and then it breaks in that weak point that you've created. Okay, well, this is creating a weak point, but look at the last 24 hours now. So we incorporate in the last 24 hours where the microquakes, and all this is going to do is connect the dots between the areas that I just named. So for instance, 2.1, this is actually at Geysers, California, Cobb, Anderson, the spot that I showed you with the geothermal pumping ops. This is Napa Valley still. This is still up next to Mount Lassen. And then we go down across the San Andreas, south by southeast of Monterey Bay, and then we end up in Southern California. And there's only a few other earthquakes to talk about. This 2.0 out here in Nevada. Warm Springs, Nevada. We're going back to Warm Springs. You know, when I zoom in on this location and I hear the name Warm Springs, I think more of the movie Dante's Peak, or I think of some kind of strange post-apocalyptic nuclear Mad Max scenario where the hot springs are radioactive waste or something. Why? Well, look where we are. This location here brings us into Goblin Knobs, which is on the southern edge of lunar craters. And lunar craters here, a huge volcanic field, blast craters, lava flows, very impressive. Again, you can pause it and read it from the Smithsonian if you want. Goblin Knobs are just an older version of lunar craters. We go down to the south, we have Sand Springs. Now, why did I bring up nuclear? Because of all this. Right here, this whole valley is nothing but underground nuclear test sites. And it doesn't just stop here. They have this marked as a volcano because it blew out. Apparently, there was some glowing ejecta that was blown out, some kind of magma. I don't know. Probably just melted material from the nuke itself. Over here are our megaton test sites. So while these are many hundreds of kilotons, each one a different underground nuke test. This one, U.S. nuke Operation Oscuro, September 21st, 1972, 160 kilotons. We have thousands of kilotons, or megatons, all the way around here and going up to the north. And down to the south, surface nuke test sites, Doomtown and Operation Riseline. Here's Area 51. The famous Groom Lake Area 51 with its double long runways and all that wonderful stuff. But we're right next to lunar craters. If you're going to ask me which one is it related to, well, it's right next to lunar craters and Goblin Knobs. But it's just north of a bunch of man-made fracture points in the crust. Now, if we go right in, if we see a new little swarm break out right inside the nuke test site tonight or something, then I'll say, okay, this too is more related to the nuke test sites. Now, they're not doing nukes there now. Those are weak points created by humans. All this proves is that the weak points, whether they're Mother Nature made at volcanoes or geothermal points, or human made at geothermal drill points or oil or gas, or at nuke test sites, that the weak points are sought out by Mother Nature as this force, this seismic force, not to be confused with earthquakes, is the force that causes the earthquakes. It spreads out across the plate, and then it hits the weak points, then precipitating an earthquake. Do you follow me? So it's not that this 3.2 causes this 3.2. It's not that Yellowstone's 3.0 causes this 3. It's that both 3s, the one at Yellowstone, the one down here next to the volcanoes in Utah, and the ones over here next to the drill points in California, all of them are caused by the same size force going across the plate and just seeking out whichever weak point it can find. So we can't really blame the oil companies any more than we can blame the geothermal companies or even the aquifer drill points in some cases. As we get down into Southern California, would you be shocked to find out if I told you this is another volcano that's also a drill point for geothermal? Cozo Junction? Cozo Volcanic Junction? Cozo Volcanic Field? That's where we're going in on. Here's the Smithsonian place mark for it. Do you think the U.S., I wonder if the USGS has access to the Smithsonian place marks. Wouldn't it be funny if they didn't? Like, you go over to their site and it just doesn't say anything. I mean, you think it would say something about click here for more information on the volcano at the location or something, but it's not. It doesn't show you the volcano there at all. So you just think it's a random earthquake. If you're just using the USGS site, you would just think this is a random earthquake out there. No reason at all. And then you go look up the epicenter and you see this rising obsidian domes, a Smithsonian place mark for the volcano that's there. And then you zoom in even further and you identify this and you see these and they're geothermal turbines and pipelines that go to drill points into the volcano. You might start to put things together. You'd say, hey, hold on. This one's next to a drill point down here, oil, and this one's next to a drill point here at a volcano. Gee, I wonder if they're related. Well, you don't get that question asking because you're not provided the information to ask the questions to begin with from the USGS. How about that? You can get more information from a guy on YouTube or Twitch than you can from the USGS. It's just a sad day for science, but it's good for me. I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you the truth. Let's go down here over into East LA, where we can actually identify fault zone earthquakes. This is something rare at this point. We're normally just looking at these drill points and these volcanoes. But this one here, East LA, a star, right where the swarm is happening. This is where the Elsinore meets into the San Jacinto, also meeting into the South San Andreas or North Imperial fault zone. So this is same thing, San Andreas and Imperial, here over on the east, the greater red line, and then the thinner red lines are the San Jacinto and Elsinore going up into LA. But I want to go look this one up. Fontana, California. Is there anything there? I mean, all three fault zones come together there. So I just want to go see. I don't know. I really don't know. I did not look this earthquake up earlier. I don't know what's there. Inquiring minds want to know, so we have to look. A shipping yard. Southwest Industrial Park. Look at the size of that thing. Dang. Is there anything else nearby? Okay, well, we have some hillsides here. Let's go see. Usually, if you've got open hillsides and they're not developed, there's some reason. They're either radioactive or they're doing something there. Okay, in this case, it looks like, what do you got going on here? Some kind of landfill. Well, okay, there's no oil or gas pumping operation at the location. That's what I'm concerned about. Now, this goes back a long way. We can go back, 80 years, 100 years, and they were doing a lot of drilling out here. Now, are they anymore? No. But 100 years ago, they had major, major drill points all across this area. Now, I don't have access to where those are, so I don't know if there were any here in Fontana. I just have to tell you that all of North LA was a massive oil field. And that's no exaggeration on my part. Here's some right here that currently exists still. Oil and gas. But that is sparse compared to what used to be here. Again, if you see the pictures of it, I wonder if I could find it. Hold on. Let's go look. Riverside, California, oil fields. Find some pictures. Long Beach's oil. Is this what it is? Going over to the east? This is just in Long Beach. Look at this. Look, those are all different derricks. So this is how they used to do it. They would have like a wooden tower that makes up the derrick itself. There. And then they replaced them with metal eventually, but it originally was wood. But what were they using it for? This is like in the mid-1800s or something. Something doesn't add up. You know what? I don't know. Hey, I just watched a mud flood video. Uh-oh. Was that muddy? I think that may have been muddy. That's a joke. Come on. Okay. That just got everybody's ears perked up now? Yeah, this is recent Tartaria stuff here we got going on. As we go down... Sorry. Let me gain my composure again. We go down to the south. And we have a diagonal line coming out of the LA Basin, going down across the Elsinore Fault. We stopped on the San Jacinto. Again, stopped on the San Jacinto. Let me show it to you one more time. these three distinct sets of red lines, the two thinner and one thicker. This is the San Andreas, this is the San Jacinto, this is the Elsinore. Elsinore is moving. San Jacinto basically stopped right here. Do you see a big stack of earthquakes there? We have a greater stack up where they all three meet. We have a smaller stack here. This is the slow slip where the smaller stack is, and it's been going for 2.5 years. But last night, all its energy just escaped out over to Texas. So I'm not shocked to see this drop off, but it's gonna flare back up. Southern California is gonna flare back up. There's energy coming your way, look at it. So it escaped out to Texas, that's good news, but it's gonna get hit again by a new incoming push. And that takes me back to the start of this whole dang broadcast, which is our deep earthquakes from down below the plate, creating new energy all the way around the plate, including up to our west by northwest, and we're gonna watch Alaska still for a few more days. I'll probably have a new forecast out this coming Sunday, not tonight. We're gonna ride the forecast that I did on Wednesday night through till Wednesday, and then there'll be a 2-day or 3-day hiatus, and then I'll start to formulate the new forecast, and we'll have next week, we'll regain on normal Sunday night thing kind of that we used to have going on. Up until then, I want you to watch this right here for a corresponding action that spreads out and away and across. So South America, West Pacific, Northwest Pacific, first three stop-offs along the way. Those are the three points that should be hit first. Now there should be other new deep activity. With this, a new deep 6.4, there should be other new deep earthquakes on top of this 4.6 and this 3.7, okay? So it's a lot going on. I'm glad I came back. I really am, because it's perfect timing. Here's a new deep quake in the mid-range 6 level that can cause up to 7. Let me put it this way. If a 7 comes popping off over in Indonesia, I don't want to hear, you know, people that say they weren't prepared, because we have a warning sign that something could happen. Now, I hope it doesn't. We hope for the best, but at this point, I want you to plan for the worst, which means to the west of this big deep quake is where we watch first. That puts us into Indonesia. The other area spreading out up and across, the good news I have for you, the longer we go and the further we get, the less it gets. That's the good news. Okay, what else do we have to talk about? Is there anything else that struck since I started my broadcast, I guess is a question to ask. And the little outbreak over here in West Turkey. Couple twos on the west coast of the United States. And that looks like it right now. Probably a good time for me to tell you to have an earthquake plan. I tell people this all the time, but I'm serious. You need to think about what you're going to do if an earthquake strikes. Where are you going to take shelter? Or are you going to go outside? If a large earthquake hits, you're going to have to do one of the two. You're going to either have to take shelter underneath something, or you're going to have to go outside to avoid getting hit by things that are falling. And if you're in a structure that can't handle the earthquake, and I don't know what kind of structure you're in, but if you think your structure can't handle a large earthquake, you need to have an immediate exit plan, which means you need to know which door to go out. You need to know what's outside. I mean, there's so many things that you have to take into consideration if you're going to run outside. So you need to know your surroundings. And then if you're going to go outside, what if it's freezing cold or boiling hot out? You know, you need to have the appropriate gear in a bag that you can grab, a bug out bag, an emergency kit that you can grab at a moment's notice, and have that somewhere easily accessible, whether it's by a door or somewhere you can grab it. Don't have it stashed away in a closet somewhere. Have it so you can grab it easy and either take it outside or to use after a disaster inside. Whether it's a flood or a fire or an earthquake or severe weather, you can have all those things, those basic needs. And that's a change of clothes, set of shoes, extra keys, insurance card, ID, debit card, extra one of the, each one of those in a bag, along with flashlight, battery, emergency radio, way to charge your mobile phone. These are just the basics, guys. You're supposed to have it met anyways. You're supposed to have a first aid kit at your house, right? With Band-Aids and things to clean yourself. You should have that in a kit, so you don't have to fumble all around your house for it. I'm just telling you, so you can do it yourself. You can use my chiding sound here that I've got to get you to do it. If any, even one life is saved because somebody had an emergency kit, I'll feel like I did my job for all the times that I had to say it online. My God, how many times would, you know, is it worth it to say online a million times, do it and you save one life from it? That would be amazing. So I would encourage you guys to be prepared. What else? Do you want to support my operation? If you would like to support me, you don't have to. No pressure. We got dutchsinse shirts, stickers, all that good stuff, sweatshirts to meet every price point. It goes from like $6 up to $40. And I appreciate anybody who helps with that. Let's go over to YouTube. Say hi to everybody on YouTube. Hello, everyone on YouTube. Looks like my channel's doing all right. Please share the information if you can. And let's jump over to Twitch. If you guys want a 24/7 live ongoing stream, you come over to Twitch, check it out. There's lots of good people in chat, and you can share seismic data with people and connect across the world. And if something big hits, you'll probably hear about it first before you even hear about it on the USGS or even on any public feed. So that's good to see with the community that's building online. You guys are incredible, and thank you for sticking around. I'll be back. Hey, here we are on screen wearing my triggered NPC shirt. And back behind me, Dinafash. Dinafash Susanik. Outlander. We've got the Outlander. I got this for my wife. This is the funniest story. My wife and I watch Outlander, and it's just funny. This is Jamie Frazier from Outlander. And I bought this for Christmas as the cardboard cutout, and I had it sitting by the coffee pot. And she walked around the corner, and it scared her. And then we've been using it ever since around the house. She'll come in and put it like around a corner, and I'll come around, and it looks like a grown man, like in the dark. It really looks like an intruder in the house. And since we've got all the doxing and all the people threatening me and stuff, oh man, she scared me so many times. So now we have a little joke where we take him around the house and we put him in and he's the intruder. It's hilarious. So anyways, he's here on the stream right now, chilling in the subway with us, keeping me, looking over me, keeping guard. God bless his heart. I appreciate it, Jamie Frazier. Peace out, guys.